Om namo bhagavate vasudevaya.
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 Narayanam namaskrutya. Ajagareṇa,
ajagareṇa,
pa,
pa,
gīrṇeṣv ajagareṇa,
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 gīrṇeṣv ajagareṇa.
Kim,
kim,
no,
no,
na,
na,
kuśalaṁ,
kuśalaṁ,
brūyāṁ,
brūyāṁ,
kim, no, na, kuśalaṁ, brūyāṁ,
kim, no, na, kuśalaṁ, brūyāṁ,
kim, no, na, kuśalaṁ,
gata-śrīṣu, gṛheṣv,
gata-śrīṣu, comparison of Krishna to the sun is very appropriate. As soon as the sun sets, darkness automatically appears. But a darkness experienced by the common man does not affect the sun itself, either at the time of sunrise or of sunset. Lord Krishna's appearance and disappearance are exactly like that of the sun. He appears and disappears in innumerable universes, and as long as he is present in a particular universe, there is all transcendental light in that universe. But the universe from which he passes away is put into darkness. His pastimes, however, are everlasting. The Lord is always present in some universe, just as the sun is always present either in India or in America. But when the sun is present in India, the American land is in darkness. And when the sun is present in America, the Indian land is in darkness. The Indian hemisphere is in darkness. As the sun appears in the morning and gradually rises to the meridian, and then again sets in one hemisphere while simultaneously rising in the other, so Lord Krishna's disappearance in one universe and the beginning of his different pastimes in another take place simultaneously. As soon as one pastime is finished here, it is confirmed. As soon as one pastime is finished here, it is manifested in another universe. And thus, this Nitya Leela or eternal pastimes are going on without ending. As the sunrise takes place once in 24 hours. Similarly, the pastimes of Lord Krishna take place in a universe once in a day time of Brahma, the account of which is given in the Bhagavad Gita as 4,300,000,000 solar years. But wherever the Lord is present, all his different pastimes are, as described in the revealed scriptures, take place at regular intervals. As at sunset, the snakes become powerful, thieves are enraged, goats become active, the lotus becomes disfigured, and the Chakravarti laments, so with the disappearance of Lord Krishna, the atheists feel enlivened and the devotees become swarming. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta Purport. Omanyanatimirandasya jnananjanashalakaya chakshurunitam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha nama om vishnam vadaya krishna prasthaya bhutale shri mane bhakti vedanta swami dinamine namaste saraswate deve gauravani prasadine nirvishesha shunyavadi paschatya deshatarine Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare
Uddhava is being questioned by Vidura. Vidura specifically asked about Krishna and Krishna's relatives. Vidura is on a pilgrimage and he has also asked Uddhava to glorify the Lord, the Supreme Lord Krishna. Because a devotee always likes to hear the glories of the Lord. So Uddhava, as soon as he was reminded of Krishna, he went into ecstasy. His voice got choked up and he could not speak. So for a moment, he was silent. And as the ecstasy was appearing in his body, there were tears flowing down from his eyes. So, they describe that he wiped away the tears and slowly came back, gradually came back to the material plane. And now he has begun to speak. He is telling Krishna has gone back to his abode. Kṛṣṇe-dyumaṇi. Krishna has his personal abode, Swadhama. And Uddhava is telling Vidura, Krishna has gone back to his own abode. In fact, Krishna comes from that place when he incarnates. He comes from the spiritual world to the material world. When he comes, there is a big celebration. There is a lot of joy. But when he returns, then people feel the celebration. People feel grief. Devotee is grief. So, Śrī Uddhava explains, Uddhava could understand the grief of Vidura and he wanted to sympathize with Vidura. So, Uddhava is speaking in this way that there is no question of welfare when Krishna is not present. Without Krishna, there is no question of welfare. And Uddhava is telling, it is just like at sunset there is darkness. Like that, the whole world, after Krishna passed away, or Krishna went back to his abode. Krishna does not die, neither we die, but anyway, still there is a difference. When Krishna comes or he leaves this planet and goes to his personal world, he doesn't have to accept a material world or give up a material world. He comes in his spiritual form, he performs all his pastimes in his spiritual form, and he returns to the spiritual world, his personal abode, in his spiritual form. Whereas we have to accept the material body and we have to quit the material body at the right time. So for devotees, it is told, Tyaktva deham punarjanmanaiti mahamiti sojuna. So if the devotee is concerned, there is no rebirth. Punarjanmanaiti. And what happens? Mami, devotees go to Krishna's personal abode. So for devotees and the Lord, there is no lamentation due to all this material world. But still, devotees like Uddhava who are attached to the Supreme Lord Krishna, if they are staying back beyond Krishna's personal presence, even though Krishna is returning, Uddhava is not there. Uddhava is staying back. So Uddhava feels separation from the Lord. And therefore, Uddhava is telling, there is the question of welfare of our house. Because Krishna is no longer there, there is no question of welfare. Without Krishna, nobody can be happy. Nobody can think of doing any good to others or oneself. So Uddhava is thinking there is no question of our welfare if Krishna is not there. So these are spiritual emotions, and they are not to be mistaken with some material emotions. If somebody dies in a particular family, the family members feel grief. They may sometimes even cry. But such grief or sorrow or crying is actually completely in the bodily conception. So such grief is an effect of illusion. Because wrongly we are ending up in the body and bodily connections. We become attached. We become attached to the body, we become attached to the bodily connections. And then we feel loss, sorrow, grief, separation. But when a devotee is attached to Krishna, devotee develops bhakti, then there is a transformation of his consciousness, because of which, in spite of the material body, the devotee acts on the spiritual platform. His thoughts, his words, his actions, everything are in relationship with Krishna. They are all profound on the spiritual platform. So on the spiritual platform also, a devotee has feelings towards Krishna. And a devotee will feel joy in the personal presence of Krishna, may feel sorrow in separation from Krishna. But these are spiritual emotions. They are not due to the effect of the illusory energy. They are completely spiritual. They are actually under the shelter, protection of Krishna's spiritual potency called Yoga Maya. Yoga Maya facilitates the pastimes of Krishna. Krishna's pastimes with the devotees. So Yoga Maya creates all the proper atmosphere for all such Krishna's pastimes, arranges for Krishna's pastimes. Because Krishna is the Supreme Lord, he has nothing to do. He is simply engaged in some pastime, some leela, and all his energies are working. But his energies are working differently. The material energy is working for creating illusion among the conditioned souls. His internal energy or spiritual energy is working for arranging Krishna's pastimes. So the two are differently working, not working the same. But the acharyas explain that this material energy ultimately is also, because it's an energy of Krishna, it is also spiritual. It's not material reality. Only if I, as a conditioned soul, want to enjoy this world, the material energy will work as illusory energy. If I want to engage in devotional service to Krishna, the same material energy will work as spiritual energy. Then, in devotional service, there is no illusion. There is no effect of the material energy in the form of illusory influence. There is no illusory influence. So even though we say this material energy is very dangerous, it's entangling, it puts us into forgetfulness of Krishna, that is only if we are desirous of enjoying this world, we are desirous of being away away from Krishna. We want to be forgetful of Krishna. We want to be away from Krishna. Then only the mental energy acts as the energy. But if we want to serve Krishna, we want to remember Krishna, we want to surrender to Krishna, we want to lead our life in the relationship with Krishna, we want to do everything for Krishna, then the same material energy acts as yoga maya, acts as spiritual energy, reminds us of Krishna, helps us to serve Krishna, facilitates our devotional service. Then somebody may ask the question, why do devotees have any obstacles at all? The material energy is facilitating, supposed to facilitate our devotional service. When we try to do devotional service, why should there be any impediment? These impediments actually are nothing but our own material attachments. All impediments are our own material attachments. They are not due to the illusory influence of the material energy. Because if you examine deep within your heart, you will see if you are practicing spiritual life properly, you will see so many anarthas are there, unnecessary things, unwanted things. So these unwanted things are present in the heart as so many material attachments, so many material misconceptions, so many material desires for enjoying in this world. So they are the obstacles, they are the impediments, they are the difficulties for us in devotional service. Otherwise, devotional service can very easily be performed by anybody in any situation, any circumstance. Just like sometimes people may complain, my body is giving me so much trouble, I cannot do devotional service. Now this body itself, what is this body? We should always remember this body has been given to us for what? Because we wanted to enjoy material. Otherwise, there's no need for this body. You have your spiritual form. You have your spiritual senses. You have your spiritual intelligence. You don't require this material body, material intelligence, material senses. You don't require them. Then why have they been given? Because you want to enjoy materially. So if somebody decides, I don't enjoy materially, I serve Krishna, I only engage in devotional service, then this body is not required. Please understand, this body is not required. Even though, as long as the body is there, we may utilize it in Krishna service. We utilize it in Krishna service if it can be utilized. If it cannot be utilized, forget it. Don't bother with it. It is just like somebody's tongue can be vibrated. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. You chant Hare Krishna using your tongue. What if somebody's tongue, something happens, and they're not able to vibrate the tongue and chant Hare Krishna? Okay, don't vibrate the tongue. Remember the holy name. Hear the holy name. Think of the holy name. Internally chant Hare Krishna. So, devotional service can be performed with these senses, material senses, with all the material things we have, we can engage them, but they are not absolutely necessary. A As long as they're there, engage them. Because if we don't engage our senses and our material possessions in Krishna's service, our attachment for them will not go away. Attachment remains. So it is just for detachment that we have to engage these senses, this material possessions, material body, etc. But if we learn the art of devotional service, that is the art of performing devotional service without becoming attached or dependent on different material things. That's why this material detachment also, we say cultivate material detachment. Why material detachment is necessary? It's not only to counteract the material attachment, it's also because we should learn the technique of doing devotional service with our spiritual senses, with our spiritual intelligence, with our spiritual possessions, whatever we have. So, to learn that, you should also practice or try to cultivate material detachment. Just like if I can go to the temple, and in the temple I can chant Hare Krishna, very nice. Supposing I can't go to the temple, so does it mean I will not chant Hare Krishna? No, I should still chant Hare Krishna wherever I am. So for that, a certain amount of detachment has to be cultivated. Not that our mind becomes disturbed if we are unable to go to temple. Well, how can I chant Hare Krishna? Why am I not able to go to the temple? Why is Krishna not helping me by facilitating my go to the temple? So all these type of rebellious nature is not going to help us. So to understand that materially, whatever situation we may be in, we can always render devotional service to Krishna. Haituki apratihata. Haituki means without any material reason. And apratihata means without any impediment. Without any material impediment. Without any material motivation. Without any stoppage under all circumstances, at all times, in all places, by everyone, devotional service can be done. But then there are different types of service you can do. Devotional service is not limited. Unlimited varieties of devotional service are there. Simply if you sit in a place and simply go back in memory and try to remember all the devotional service you have done in the past. All the things you have heard about Krishna. All the kirtans you have chanted. All the times you have had darshan. Now I cannot be able to have darshan of a particular deity. Like yesterday we were in Parthasarathi temple. Right? So, when you go and have darshan, okay, for that time, you are having darshan. But you also carry the impression of the deity in your heart. And that impression of the deity in the heart is your internal asset for your devotional service. Any time you can bring back remembrance of that impression of the deity. and again have darshan, you will not be again visiting the temple, but you again have darshan. How many times can you have? Any number of times. Millions of times, billions of times. Right? You see, people say, every month I go to Tirupati to have darshan of Bhagavad. Very nice. Supposing somebody is not able to go every month. You can still have darshan of Balaji every month. You have to practice, you have to learn this art of devotion skills. You see, defensive quality of having darshan. If you have the facility, you can every day have darshan. Your darshan, the time you go and have darshan, you will not be very, very keen on capturing that image in your heart of the Lord. But I tell you, only once you can have darshan, after that only your impression, only your memory. So carefully you will have darshan and try to properly have the impression. Correct? So our quality of devotion and service can simply be enhanced by material impediments. So actually material impediments are not impediments. They are simply taken in another way. Either you consider the material impediments as due to your attachments, material attachments, for your own personal enjoyment. Or you may take it, okay, I don't have really any material attachments so much. Then you may take it like they are impetus for you to enhance your quality of devotional service. That means every opportunity you get for devotional service, the quality of service should keep on increasing. If you get a chance to hear about Krishna, hear very, very nicely. So you will never forget what you have heard. So then afterwards you can constantly keep remembering again and again and again and again. Sutta Goswami, he sat and heard Bhagavatam from Sukadeva Goswami. Now the entire Bhagavatam he is narrating to the sages of Vaidisharanya. They are sitting and hearing with rapt attention. And they are going on asking questions and he is going on answering. He is completely enlivened to speak. How is he able to do that? Because he heard very nicely. He also heard with rapt attention. Otherwise he cannot speak. Shukadeva Goswami. What all he is describing, so many different types of questions Parikshit Maharaj is asking. Because he has heard from his father Vyasadeva, he has studied under his father Vyasadeva. Thoroughly studying under his father. So he is able to describe the various pastimes of the various incarnations, the different details of the structure of the universe. So many details Srila Goswami is giving them out. How is he able to give all these details? So it's because he has studied, he has heard. With full attention he has done that. So, he is answering Parikshit's questions, speaking the Bhagavatam becomes devotional service. Pure devotional service. So, that is the quality of service we should aim for. Then, wherever we are, whatever service we are doing, the quality of the service will be enhanced and we do it very, very nicely. Material world, constantly it is changing. Situations are changing. Our body is changing.
Our positions are changing, medical positions are changing. So many circumstances are changing. So in this changing world, how do we remain steady in our devotion service? How can we become fixed up in our devotion service? Not by making material arrangements. Somebody may think, oh, there is a nice temple here. Let me buy one house near the temple so that I can stay in that house and every day visit the temple, every day participate in all the temple pastimes. Nothing wrong in such a desire or a plan. But what if somebody is unable to execute this plan, carry forward this desire and fulfill it? That means their whole devotional service is completely spoiled. No. If you can, make arrangements so that your devotional service can be done in one way, go ahead and do it. Be successful. Because you should be executing devotional service throughout your life nicely. Yes. But if you cannot, then whatever the changed circumstances, you can still do devotional service. Just pray to Krishna, give me intelligence. Now in this new situation, how do I perform devotional service? What do I do? So Krishna will guide you. Krishna will direct you from within the heart. Or if you are unable to pray to Krishna like that, you can talk to devotees to Krishna. You can speak to Vaishnavas and take their help, take their guidance. What do I do? Like one devotee, he went from Chennai to someplace Edinburgh, Scotland. So Edinburgh, no temple, no devotees. And home is doing something, doing some reading, doing something. But something more can be done. Yes, I told him, go on and preach. But who is listening to? Nobody is interested in hearing about Krishna consciousness. So doesn't matter. Try. Try your best. And now what has happened is he has gradually discovered, made friends with some people who somehow in the past, some of them had some connection with Krishna consciousness. And they had left and gone away from Krishna consciousness. Now they are coming back. The gathering, and now they are having a weekly program, and they are planning how to bring more people to their program. So some new people are also coming now, who don't know anything about Krishna consciousness. They are learning, oh, there is something like this. So, in a new situation, it has given a bigger challenge for engaging in preaching. And it's so exciting for the devotee now. It's so exciting. So regularly I am receiving report about what are the different programs, what are the different challenges they face, how they overcome the disappearance. Discuss. So many things are happening. It's very enlightening. So also Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wants to spread this Krishna consciousness in every town and village. Krishna wants that his teachings be spread everywhere. Krishna spoke to Arjuna, the Bhagavad Gita, but it was not meant only for Arjuna. That is why Krishna spoke on the battlefield of Kuruksheta. Krishna chose that particular place. Why? Because Krishna wants to teach us the message of Bhagavad Gita is universal. It's for everyone. It's for the whole world. The whole world represented by different kings had assembled there in the battlefield of Kurukshetra. So Krishna spoke the Bhagavad Gita in the battlefield of Kurukshetra. Through Arjuna, he wanted to speak the Bhagavad Gita for the benefit of everyone. He made Arjuna a student, but actually it is not actually for Arjuna. It was for the others. So, if this message has to spread and we can be some kind of instrument in spreading this message to Krishna consciousness, then we should try to utilize whatever facilities, whatever opportunities, whatever situations we have or we are placed in spreading this message. So, month of December and January, we are going to have what is called as Prabhupada's book marathon, book distribution marathon. Prabhupada wrote books, and he specially wanted these books to be distributed all over the world to everyone. So these books are very, very special.